Well, hi, everybody. This is Alan Arnette with another episode of the podcast on alanarnette.com. It is Sunday, April the 17th, Easter for many people around the world. So happy Easter to all of you. Well, let's take a look at Everest. Let's see what happened this past week, what's going on just in general, what's coming up next week. And then I want to pick up where we left off last week with leaving Tengboche Monastery. Let's go up to the base camp and see what base camp is like and experience Puja, which for me is one of the most emotional and meaningful experiences of climbing with Sherpas anywhere in the Himalaya. So this past week, activity is really strong. A lot of people are still trekking in, and a lot of people arrived at base camp to begin the process of acclimatizing there and practicing some basic skills. The permit, it did increase as expected, but I think it's flattening out now. As of April the 15th, the Ministry of Tourism has issued 738 total climbing permits for every mountain, all the 21 or 22 peaks in Nepal that are being climbed this year. But for Everest is 262. Of that, that includes 56 female climbers, which is a continuing trend of seeing more and more female climbers each year on Everest. In terms of who is there, the United States has the most number of climbers with 58. And again, that's a spot that was recently held by both China and India. And for reasons we've talked about before, with China, with the travel restrictions due to COVID. In India, I'm still unclear exactly as to why there's not more people coming from India. But nonetheless, they only have 21 from India this year. Last year, it was in the 60s or 70s. There's only 9 from China, which is understandable. The UK comes in after the US with 33. Canada has 14, Australia 10, and Russia has 16. And Ukraine even has a climber, a young lady there that's trying to climb and to summit Everest to honor her country. So as I said, Everest Base Camp is filling up. You can always go to the tracking table on my blog to see exactly which team, your favorite team is there. I'm doing my best to update that. Pretty much now they all have a little T beside them, or a B, which means Everest Base Camp, or an X rather. So also looking at the other 8,000 meter mountains, there's activity still on Dalagiri, Annapurna, also on Kanchenjunga and Makalu. Looking at just real briefly, let's take this segue right now. It looks like on Annapurna, we're going to see some summits happening perhaps this week. I think they're looking at the summit day on the 19th, which would be, a couple of days from now on Tuesday over there. So that would be great to see Annapurna get some nice summits. And also on Dalagiri. Dalagiri, Carlos Soria and Cito Cartavela. Carlos at 83 with a knee prosthetic. This is his 13th attempt on Dalagiri. We all know his story. He wants to get all 14 of the 8,000 meter peaks. He has tried 12 times on Dalagiri and not made it, and now he's back. And the good news is, I'm really super excited for him that they are already up to camp 2. I think there's nobody else in the mountain at the moment climbing, that is. There may be some people at base camp still preparing, but not climbing. So he and Cito are at camp 2, well on their way to the summit. The weather forecast looks good. So we may see Carlos knock off number 13 on his 13th attempt on April the 18th in Nepal, or maybe the 19th. So I am just pulling for him with all of my heart. Really hope that he makes it this time. I really, really do. So sending our best, most positive energy to Carlos and Cito over there. So returning back to Everest and kind of looking at the bigger picture last week. You know, last week was a sad news week and a good news week. The sad news was that we saw two people die on the mountains. Very highly experienced Greek climber, Antonis Sikaris, 59 years old. He died somewhere around 7,400 meters after summiting at the 8,167 meters. So he was down, roughly 700 meters. You know, that's a couple of thousand feet from the summit. when it looks like that he suffered this extreme exhaustion, and around noon on Monday, April the 11th, he passed away. He was with only one Sherpa, a Dawa Sherpa, and they were using the logistics of Seven Summits treks. His home team noted that there was not additional oxygen available for him. I would suggest it was also not available medical oxygen. It's really pretty standard for most of the best teams to have at least a bottle or two of emergency medical oxygen at the high camp in case this very scenario occurs. So just a tragic death of a super, super climber. Everything that I've heard and read and people I know that knew Antonis that said that he was just a super, super nice human being. So leaves behind a wife, daughter, and a granddaughter. So really our hearts go out to the family, the teammates, to Dawa Sherpa. That must have been incredibly difficult for him as well to see his client die. The other death was of Nima Tenji Sherpa, 38 years old. He was a Sherpa climbing with IMG, International Mountain Guides, and they were doing a rotation. Nima was with 11 other Sherpas, and Nima was carrying loads up to Camp 1, which is what everybody is doing right now on Everest. And for some reason, he sat down near the football field, which is about halfway up the icefall, and he passed away. They found his body lifeless, sitting straight up with his backpack still on. There was no avalanche, there was no fall, no obvious trauma. So, not really clear what happened. It was probably altitude related in one way or another. So again, just always tragic when anybody dies, but I always find it more tragic when a Sherpa dies while carrying these loads, you know, for their customers. I'm sure IMG will take care of his family. That's what they've always done. They're a first class outfit when it comes to these type of tragedies. And so I'm sure that Nima's family will be taken care of, plus through organizations like the Juniper Fund. Melissa Arnott is one of the founders of that, along with Dave Moore. No, I forgot. Anyway, so they do a great job of taking care of the families of Sherpas who have fallen. So I'm sure that their family will be taken care of to some extent. So everybody arrived at Everest Base Camp this week, or not everybody, a lot of people did. Probably, I don't know, 10 teams did. There's 32 teams now that have permits on Everest, and probably 10 or 15 arrived at Everest Base Camp. And those first days are always interesting. The whole point is that after trekking in, which a lot of people are trekking, there's a lot of talk about helicopters and using helicopters and not trekking in. That may be true on some of the other 8,000 meter mountains, but not on Everest. I would say 80%, it used to be 100%, but now it's 80% of people do go ahead and trek in. Some are shaking a shortcut to go to Namche. I've talked about this before. I think it's just go to Lukla and just follow the path and just take it all in and enjoy just this very, very special place in the world. But they get there and so they rest up for a day or two. You know, they're getting used to that new altitude. It's around 17,000 feet, 5334 meters. And so then they begin to review some basic skills. So what they do is the guides set up an obstacle course, if you want to call it that, right next to their camp in the foot of the Khumbu Icefall. A lot of ice pinnacles there, so they could set up a fixed rope to go up a very steep ice wall. They could put some ladders across a couple of pinnacles with a gap in between. And so the Sherpas go up there, and they're going to work with you to make sure that you really understand how to clip in and clip out and go over protection. In other words, those pitons and ice screws that are holding the fixed rope into the mountain, it's very critical that you get that down into your muscle memory, because you're gonna be doing it literally hundreds of times over the next 6 weeks. You know, you've got this a safety carabiner, and then you have your Jumar, and you come up to the anchor and you take your safety and move it across so it's on top of the protection, and then you take your Jumar and then you move it over, and then that's got you complete, so now you can keep on going. But you always, always, always put that protection in, that safety in, because that is what's going to save your life if you do make a mistake and make a slip or something like that. So it's always safety with the safety first. How's that? So anyway, they practice that. They practice going across the ladder, having the right technique. Because, you know, the rungs of the ladder are only, I don't know what they are, 12, 18 inches apart. No, you go measure it. But your foot, everybody has a different size foot. I've got a little bitty tiny 8.5 foot 8.5 US foot, but I use a 11, a 41 in European size in my climbing boots. And, but, you know, so my foot's this wide and somebody else's foot may be, you know, this massive longer one, another 2 or 3 inches. And so they can easily put the front of their crampons on the front rung, the back on the back rung. Me, I typically have to put the center of my boot on the rungs in the middle. And, you know, that runs the risk of bending the expansion bar underneath your boot. But those are the things that you figure out, and you figure them out before you go into the ice fall. I always say never, ever do use some equipment or do a technique for the first time on a climb that's very important to you. But even going like to Rainier, just never, ever do something for the first time when you arrive at the mountain. Do it back home at a lower altitude where if you mess up, it's not that big of a deal. You're going to learn from it, but it's not the time to mess up when you're in the ice fall. And honestly, if you don't know how to do a lot of this stuff before you get to Everest, you know, you probably shouldn't be there. Okay. So Wi-Fi is available at Everest Base Camp through Everest Link. It looks like the pricing is, I don't know, about the same as last year. 1 gigabyte is about $45. And if you're really a data hog, then you can get 10 gigabytes for about $180. So me with my blogging, I always bought the most and just, you know, factor that into the cost of climbing, you know. But if you're just going to be sending some emails, you know, 1 gigabyte's fine. If you're going to be doing occasional FaceTime, maybe 2 or 5 gigabytes. But if you're going to be blogging daily and uploading pictures and videos, yeah, you better go for the break out a couple of $100 bills. And by the way, they only take US dollars in cash. So make sure you got enough cash with you when you go up there. Maybe they'll take a rupee, but they prefer the US dollars. So looking forward, next week, there will be a lot of teams going into the ice fall for the first time. And this is always just a moment. You know, when you go to crampon point and you put those crampons on, you look up, it's probably 3 o'clock in the morning. You look up above you, you see this line of headlamps going up. It's cold and maybe windy. You love it. I mean, this is the beginning of your true Everest experience. The trek was fantastic, but now you get to actually begin to climb. And I'm going to talk a lot more about that in the post coming up. And on next weekend's update, we'll talk about the first time going through the Khumbu ice fall. You know, back to the multiple 8,000 meter mountains that are being climbed. Again, you know, we've seen this with last year with COVID, there were a lot of people that were planning to do Dalagiri and then also Annapurna. So I decided to look into this because I saw a headline that said that it's now trendy and popular to climb multiple 8,000 meter mountains. So I thought, really, let's just kind of quantify this. So I used the good old Himalayan database to take a look at it. And sure enough, one of those most popular doubles is doing the Everest Lhotse double. And in fact, there have been 90 people that have gone summited Everest and then gone over and summited Lhotse. Now, here's how they make that work. As they summit Lhotse, come back down to the South Col, rest up, go all the way back down and over to the high camp on Lhotse, which is still pretty, pretty high. And they make that, and then they get to, let's see, what the high camp on Lhotse is at 7,800 meters. So they're down only 150 meters from the South Col. So they go from there over down 150 meters, and then they go up to the summit of Lhotse, then they go back down. So, you know, I personally think that you should at least return to camp too. I know I'm in the minority, and I know everybody, the people that are listening to this that have summited Lhotse by Everest, you know, they're going, oh, Alan, you know, you're full of it and all this stuff, but okay, call me old school. I will totally own that. You know, but then if you look at the other so-called doubles out there that, you know, look at Everest and Cwm. Well, there's been 10 of those. In other words, 10 people have gone probably from Cwm to Everest. Annapurna, Everest combo, 3. Makalu Everest, 1. So if you look at the Dalagiri, Annapurna, you know, which was very popular, a lot of people talk about it. The facts show there's only been 4. Dalagiri, Makalu, only 2. So in other words, it's just a handful, under 5, other than Everest Lhotse and Everest Cwm, where the double has actually been accomplished. And the problem is that Everest Lhotse, you know, is quote unquote, and I never like to use this word, but it's very achievable. I was going to say easy, but I don't like that word. So it's very achievable. But, you know, going from Dalagiri to Annapurna, well, only four people have done it. And the problem is that once you summit Dalagiri, you got to go all the way back down, probably Kathmandu or Pokhara. And now you're down, you know, much, much lower than, you know, the South Col on Everest. And so basically you got to start up and climb that 8,000 meter mountain once again. So it's very, very physical, very difficult. And those people that do it, you know, good on you, good on you. So anyway, back to the permits just for a second. Again, 262 on Everest for 32 teams. This is about what I was expecting, around 30 teams, somewhere between 250 and 300. We may see another 10, 15, even 20. So, but I don't, it just looks like right now we're not going to break 300. Remember last year, there were 408 permits. So Everest is going to have a lower level of activity this year. But take that permit and then double it, because we've got at least one high altitude worker. Now kind of using that term as opposed to Sherpas, because there's lots of other ethnicities that are on the mountain other than Sherpas, but clearly Sherpas dominated. So I think the terms are pretty well interchangeable. You know, Amon Blanc, very popular this spring, 65 permits, foreigner permits with 6 teams. Annapurna was 26, Dalagiri was 27. Kanchenjunga, now that has really taken off. And this year there's 67 climbers on 6 teams on Kang, which is a huge number of people. Makalu, another popular 8,000 meter mountain, has 39 people on it. Nupsi, which I don't understand, because Nupsi is incredibly difficult and dangerous to climb. There's 38 people on that. They probably got it on. They're probably Everest or Lhotse climbers that think they can just add that on as an additional mountain. Again, lots of people have tried Nupsi. The vast majority have not reached the true summit, because a heavily corniced summit that's suicidal in some years to climb. Maybe this year is different. Maybe it'll be safe and everybody can get up there safely and tag that true summit. We'll see. Okay, I want to switch a little bit now and just kind of pick up where we left off last week. We were at Tengboche, a lot of Shays. We were at Tengboche Monastery. We had gone in, we had seen the yaks on the front field in front of the monastery. We went in and listened to the monks chanting and doing their morning and afternoon prayers, and really touched us spiritually. Went back to the tea house, woke up that next morning with a glorious view of Amon Blanc. What else? Of course, if you're on the trek in the Khumbu, what else are you going to say is a glorious view? Amon Blanc. But it always is, just always inspiring. So we head up to the little village of Tengboche, which is where my guardian angel in the mountains, Kami Sherpa, lives with his wife, Lapka Dicky. And right now his son, Mingma Sherpa, is living with him. They're helping to rebuild the house after the earthquake in 2015. And so you go there and maybe have lunch, visit the monastery there. And then you head on, keep on heading up higher and higher and higher. And what's happening now is that slowly but surely you're leaving the tree line, and all you see is this tundra. And there's this nice little, you know, woven path right in the middle of it. And I always try to stay on that path so as not to do anything to disrupt this tundra, which takes centuries to grow and only a moment to destroy. So I don't think it's a good trade-off. But stay in the middle of that little dirt path, and you head up and you start getting above the trees. All of a sudden, it starts feeling more barren and more remote than anything you've ever felt. You know, and at this point, you begin to really think, wow, I'm pretty far away from home. This is different than anything I've ever been in. So you begin to let all that sink in. You're still having the echoes of the monks chanting in your ears, and, you know, the sound of the Dodikoshi River rushing down below. So all of this is now starting to seep deep inside of you as you get higher and higher. You may go to Tengboche to spend a night or two for acclimatization. But then you head over and you drop down a little bit and you head up another pretty steep hill. It's kind of surprising how steep this one is. And you come up to what's called the Sherpa Memorial. And, you know, this is another one of those moments on a trek. And it doesn't matter if you're trekking or you're going to climb, that it seeps into you. What you see, you crest the hill and you see just this long wall, this long grouping of chortens and long row of chortens, and they're just standing maybe 10 or 15 apart. Each one's I don't know, 4 to 6 feet high, made of stone that has been quarried from the local area, just picked up from the ground. And each one of these chortens represented a climber who has died on Mount Everest or on some of the other local peaks. Mostly it's Everest and mostly it's Sherpas. There's some really famous people like Scott Fisher, you know, Mountain Madness, who died in 1997 on Everest. But there's a lot of other Sherpas like Babu Sherpa, who fell in a crevasse near Camp 2, who died, and many other foreigners and Sherpas that the names we just don't recognize, but their families have put them up there. And they're right at the base, and off in the distance, you can see Pumori. And, you know, about that time, a porter goes by carrying a load, and, you know, you just kind of look at him and you think about all the sacrifices that people make, you know, so that other people can climb these mountains. But it's a source of money. It's a source of commerce, of tourism. So, you know, everybody will benefit from this. But some people, you know, at this point, more foreigners have lost their life on Everest. But still, it doesn't matter. Close to 309 people or something like that have died on Everest. And about 40% have been Sherpas. And many of these chortens are there to memorialize them. But you realize how dangerous it is. And you begin to think about really what you're getting into. So you leave that area with really just a deep sense of looking introspective feelings, and just, you know, thinking about the families and, you know, they lost loved ones. I remember one year I went there, and right before I left, I had a gentleman send me an email, and he said, "Alan, would you please look for the memorial of my son in the Sherpa memorial area?" I tell you, I took that, I actually printed out that email and took it with me. And when I got there, I opened it up and made sure I had his name proper. And I went to every single memorial to see if I could find his son's memorial. Sadly, I couldn't, but I think I was able to carry the father's spirit to the son's spirit in that moment, in that high place in Nepal, surrounded by the other memorials, and had maybe had a sense of peace and calmness for the father for losing his son in one of these mountain climbs. It's an area that really touches you. So keep on going. You go up to the last one, maybe Parashay, then on up to Gorit Shep. And again, you're crossing the, you know, little streams, and there's yaks everywhere. Now it's only yaks, no mules, no zoos, only the professionals, the big heavy yaks carrying the big gear, you know, and they're going along. I love it when half the time the yaks are being driven by these Sherpanis, these Sherpa women, and they're whistling at them and throwing rocks at them. I mean, they have got these yaks under total control. I just always have to step aside and turn on the video and the camera, and they record that, and they go by and I go, "Namaste." And they kind of look at me, and I was like, "Okay, namaste." Because they've seen this 100 times a day, it seems like, for the last 20 years, but I always enjoy it. So we finally get up to Gorit Shep, maybe go over and tag Kalapatar, which is what I often call the Trekker's Summit, you know, and that's the first time that you can get a really clear view of Everest. And you, maybe the plume is out depending upon the day. It's not a difficult climb to get to the top. It's basically a fairly smooth trail at a reasonably aggressive angle, maybe 20, 30 degrees. It takes a couple of hours to get up there, and then you come back down. But spending time up there surrounded by fluttering prayer flags and just looking at Everest, and off to the distance, of course, you see, wait for it, Amun Ablam, and maybe some other of the big peaks around. You know, it's just spellbounding. And if that's your high point, well on you, good on you. I mean, congratulations for getting there. If you're going on higher, then congratulations, getting up to the top of Kalapatar and seeing your final objective. Again, it really brings things into focus. So you come down Kalapatar, maybe you have lunch at Gorit Shep, maybe some more fried rice, which is becoming your favorite meal now. And then you make the last little trek over to Everest Base Camp. It's kind of undulating going up and down. There's the moraine wall from the Khumbu Glacier that's kind of lifted up the ground, and you're looking at it over to the trekker's right. And it's kind of, it can be narrow at times, maybe only a meter or two wide. Most of the time it's wider than that, maybe 3 or 4 or 5 meters. But, you know, sometimes there'll be a little rock outcropping that you got to scramble up and over. And, you know, it's just, you're getting closer and closer to that Everest Base Camp, your ultimate goal to begin the climb, or perhaps it's the end of your trek. But you're going up and down, and pretty soon you see Pumori off to the left. It's just this unbelievable, just pointy ice cream cone, sticking up. You know, it's been climbed multiple times, not so much in recent years because of avalanche danger, but that's kind of receded, and now more people are trying to get up it this year. A few more people tried in previous years, but in fact, I take that back. There's no permits right now issued for Pumori. So you come over, you're now hugging on the side of the moraine, and actually you do get to the junction heading up to Pumori, because going up to Pumori Camp 1 or 2 as an active rest day while you're climbing Everest is very popular, because you can get to basically 20,000 feet from 17.5 at Everest Base Camp. So it's a really great day for acclimatizing, no objective dangers. It's just a beautiful hike. And once you're there, you've got awesome views of Everest, not only the Khumbu and the Western Cwm, but also Lhotse right there in front and center, as well as, of course, Everest. And you see the pointy tippy top of Everest, and you can clearly see the route coming up from the Tibet side and the route coming up from the Nepal side. And in fact, you go back and you look at some of the movies of 1996 with Guy Cotter over on Pumori, when Rob Hall and his team got in trouble. He was using a sighting scope and he could see people right there at the south summit. And that was his first indication that something was going wrong over there, because it was so late in the day and the people weren't on the summit and they were still going up. So it's a great place to go to kind of bring in a little bit of history, but more importantly is to see both sides of Everest from one unique vantage point. It's just spellbounding. So we get to Everest Base Camp. We come around a corner, and sadly, there's this huge rock with Everest Base Camp written on it in graffiti. I just don't think that's great. It's a photo op for hundreds, if not thousands, but I say leave no trace. Take only pictures and leave only footsteps, and don't leave trash or graffiti or write your girlfriend's name on it. Come on, people. So then we come along and we start going into Everest Base Camp. And all of a sudden you're just kind of taken over by how many tents there are. I mean, there's tents everywhere. And like, there's this main street going through Everest Base Camp of where you see, camps on both sides, little yellow sleeping tents, just hundreds of them, if not, hundreds of them. And then you see big blue, really long blue tents that are used for cooking and dining. And these days you see these giant dome tents, these white dome tents, and they're used for the community gatherings. But some expeditions, like climbing the Seven Summits or Seven Summits Club from Russia, they're actually now providing these dome tents, the smaller dome tents, for clients to sleep in. Some of them now use these so-called box tents, which have straight up walls and they come to a top, so you can stand up inside your tent and even have a little foyer with a table and chairs for your computer, complete with a heater, a power plug, and direct contact for Wi-Fi. So, it's gone all the way from a little North Face VE25 that you got in and you're thrilled to death to have a three-person tent for one person so you can really spread your gear out, to now kind of what I still consider over the top. And I recognize that, different people have different standards, but I think when you're in the mountains, you're in the mountains, you're not in your living room, but to each his own, and I respect that. And there's clearly a market for it, because these up-end, VIP upgrades are really selling well for these guys. Lots of profit, by the way. So, it's really a great time when you pull in there. And I remember the first time that I pulled into Everest Base Camp. I was with, let me just say the last time, with IMG. And, I pulled into camp and all of a sudden I heard somebody call out my name. And I was just like, oh my gosh, they know who I am? What is this? And it wasn't that they knew who I was, but they had a roster of everybody coming in and they were kind of eliminating it, one by the other. And Zhang Bu, who was the sitar and the co-leader for IMG's base camp, just a legend there at base camp. He was the one calling out my name. And maybe Greg V was gave him a heads up for the goatee. Look for the kid with the goatee. Actually, I wasn't a kid. I was 54. Anyway, and so he called me over. I came over and it's like, namaste, Alan. I'm Zhang Bu, and let me introduce you to your personal Sherpa. And it was Kami Sherpa. And Kami, with that trademark smile, just Just, I think we instantly bonded just right there in that moment. And he would always call me his climber, and I would call him my Sherpa. And even today, I call his family my Nepali family, and he calls us his American family. In fact, I just got a happy Easter message from his daughter, Dawa. Just really touched my heart. But, you know, I got there and found my tent, you know, the one in the middle of a row of seven that have all been set up with a laser beam focus. So they're all lined up 100% perfect. You know, the Sherpas have been there weeks before digging out those tent platforms, working so hard. So I just show up and my duffel bags are already there. And that's another mystery how they linked up my duffel bags. Maybe it was my name on it. Anyway, so my duffel bags are there. So I go and crawl into my tent and, you know, begin to make it my home away from home, putting up pictures of family, pictures of friends, you know, all my little tokens of things that I need to keep me grounded and centered in my tent, lay out my down sleeping bag, my X-Ped thick down mat, put stuff in the side meshes, the top mesh, you know, really just get in there centered. Well, you know, then you go to the dining tent and have some hot Nescafe. Yeah, right. Or hot Tang. Well, whatever it is. But you know, whatever it is, you know what? It tastes fantastic when you get to Everest Base Camp. And you're so grateful for the cooks that work so hard to give you that fresh food three times a day. So you rest up for a couple of days, and then a big event happens. It's the Puja, P-U-J-A. So this is a ceremony, which is primarily driven by the Sherpas, for the Sherpas, but also on behalf of the members. And it's in to kind of net it out, a puja is a ceremony where a lama will come in from a local monastery, you know, it could be Pengboche, Tangboche, elsewhere, and he will then come in and he will pray to the gods, for the mountain gods to, for first off, permission to climb the mountain. Second is forgiveness for damaging the mountains with all of our sharp tools like crampons and ice axes and ice screws. And third, for the ultimate safety of everybody climbing. So it is this very elaborate ceremony. Typically, the lama comes in the night before and spends most of the night cooking these pastries, which are just phenomenal, just shapes and you know, different sculptures, if you will, made out of barley, fresh barley. And they bake that up. And then the next day they take those and put them out on top of this rock altar, which has been built. And it's probably, I don't know, maybe 4 feet wide or 5 feet wide by 3 feet high. And on the top of it is this wooden pole, this wooden tree trunk, which is maybe 10 feet high. And so the lama, we all come out and we know it's going to be a fairly long ceremony. I've been ones that have been half an hour. I've been one that have been 5 hours in the rain. And so you come out and the Sherpas have put out rugs and places to sit on out in front of the altar. And the Lama and then the lead Siddhar, the lead climbing Sherpa, and then there's probably a couple of other Sherpas in your team that are also Lamas. So they all sit down next to the lead Lama. And so in all the members and all the other Sherpas, kind of wandering around, but eventually everybody sits down and just kind of sits cross-legged and just takes on a tone of very respect for the ceremony. You know, there are some people that choose not to participate in that, all the way from going back to their tent and just standing on the side because it conflicts with their beliefs. And, you know, and that's totally cool with the Sherpas. You know, this is primarily for them. And if you don't want to participate, that's fine. Very consistent with the Buddhist culture of not trying to put their beliefs on anybody else. But most people do sit down and then just begin going into somewhat of a relaxed state, listening to that Lama chanting and the other Sherpas and Lamas also chanting along with them in this uniform, just like what you heard in the Pengboche Monastery, you know, this chanting that is just very relaxing. And what they're doing is they're actually praying. And if you look at the Lama, he has a 300-year-old Tibetan prayer book. So this is handwritten, I guess in Sanskrit, handwritten, and he's reading from that, and all the Sherpas are going along with him. Most of the time, it's just him by himself, but every now and then, they'll all pitch in. I've never understood it. You know, I'm not Buddhist, you know, but I just find it unbelievably emotional. What I find is the time to really sit back and reflect on why you are there, what your purpose is, and committing yourself to doing your absolute best in that moment. throughout the next 6 weeks. So at some point, the Lama finishes up the prayer, and then the next phase of this is really kind of fun. The Sherpas go and grab the prayer flags, and they begin to link them on top of the Puja pole, going across all the tents in the camp. So there may be six or seven, maybe more, maybe less, individual prayer flag streams or strings that come out. And they try to have a flag going over every single tent so that when the wind blows the flag, it's putting a blessing into that area of the camp. And when they're finished, it's just absolutely beautiful. Just, you know, there are just all these strings of prayer flags flowing out in almost every single direction. And watching the Sherpas, try to string them up without having them touch the ground is really a delight in their skill in doing that. And then, you know, sometimes right in the middle of the puja, this big black bird looks like a crow, but actually it's called a Himalayan chuff, C-H-U-F-F. This bird, black bird, lands on top of the puja pole, and that's good luck. So, and sometimes I've seen the Sherpas put a little bit of barley on top of it in order to attract the bird. I'm not sure if that's cheating or not, but I don't think it really matters. So the bird gets up there and everybody smiles and kind of looks at each other because that's, you know, that's good luck for the overall expedition. So, you know, then once the flags are up, then the Sherpas come around. And next thing you know, it's just this wild commotion. And they come up to you with a little bowl. They reach in with it and they take it and they rub barley powder on both sides of your face and on your forehead and on your nose. And what this is doing is turning your face white to represent growing old and having a white beard. Not sure how this translates to women, but nonetheless, it's the spirit that we're following here. And so for me, I didn't really need a lot, but nonetheless, you know, they cover my face in this white barley and I take it on and wear it with pride. And everybody's looking, you know, everybody's all spread with barley at that point. And then they come around with a bottle of Johnny Walker whiskey, this good old Scotch whiskey, no E in this whiskey, W-H-I-S-K-Y. And so then they pour the whiskey and they take the top of the whiskey bottle off and they pour it into the bottle cap. So this is, you know, this is not doubles happy hour. This is a cap full. And if you watch the Sherpas first, they take it and they'll put their finger into the cap and they'll drop on their finger and then they'll flip it over their left shoulder three times. And then they'll drink a cap full. You get refilled, drink it again, refill, drink it again. So everything is in threes. And they walk along and they offer this whiskey to everybody. And most people take it, some people don't. And so once the whiskey phase is over, then they move to the beer phase. And a couple of tuborgs or, you know, different types of beer comes out. And before you know it, the Sherpas are all doing line dancing. They've got their arms around each other. You know, the brave members try to jump in. And, you know, I am so uncoordinated. I've never been able to do the Sherpa dance. I say that with a fair amount of embarrassment. But nonetheless, it is time of true bonding. And everybody just has a good time at the end of the puja. You know, just really feeling, I think, in touch with the mountain, in touch with your teammates, in touch with the Sherpas, the leadership. You go back to your tent, probably sleep it off. But you gotta be careful because 9 times out of 10, that clever expedition leader will say, okay, tomorrow morning, let's get up because this is our first steps into the ice fall. We're going half up at 2, breakfast at 2:30. We're leaving by the Puja altar at 3 a.m. Now you know what you got to do. Climb on. This is Alan. And remember, memories are everything.